Alright, so in the previous videos we talked a lot about training our models. Now it's time to talk about evaluating our models and using our models on new data. So previously we mentioned the Save Hyperparameters option that allows us to save our models. And here we excluded the PyTorch model itself, which is not a hyperparameter. I am mentioning this again because it will be useful in a second. So when we are training Lightning models using the Lightning Trainer, we call .fit, and then during the fitting process, the Lightning Trainer will create model checkpoints. So model checkpoints are files that contain the whole model and the snapshot of the training so that we can reload them later. However, we can also call the save checkpoint method manually and save the model checkpoint with a preferred file name. And then once we have a checkpoint, we can reload that checkpoint using the load from checkpoint method. And notice that we are also providing the PyTorch model here as an argument, and that's because we previously excluded it when we called the save hyperparameters method. So then in order to use the model on new data, we put the model into eval mode as shown here. So this will put the model into an evaluation mode, and it will become more clear why we do that when we talk about techniques like dropout or batch normalization later on. However, it's always best practice to put the model into eval mode before we apply it to new data. And then when we use the model on new data, it's highly recommended to run this model in inference mode as shown here. So this will prevent the computation graph in the background from being constructed, and it will save you a lot of memory if you are not training the model. So in the previous slides, you have seen how we can use the model on new data. And yeah, you can pretend the test data set is new data. So let's now analyze the model on the test data set. So one thing that I find always helpful, particularly when we are working with image data, is looking at failure cases. So these are cases where the model makes wrong predictions. So here I have a plot of some of the test examples in the MNIST data set where the model makes wrong predictions. So the P here stands for predicted, and the T here stands for true label. So for example, in the upper left corner, we see that the true label is a 7, but the model predicts a 4. And in this case, as a human, I would even have a hard time seeing that this is a 7. So to me, this looks actually more like a 4 than a 7. So you can see that sometimes the model is wrong just because the predictions are not very good. But sometimes the model can also be wrong because the data labels are especially tricky. So looking at the failure cases is usually a very useful exercise, and sometimes it also helps us to detect problems in the dataset itself, which we may want to fix. Another useful way we use to evaluate our models is using confusion matrices, which we introduced earlier. So in a confusion matrix, we see the number of predicted cases for a particular class versus the number of actual cases. So in this confusion matrix, we want to maximize the scores along the diagonal. So now that we have outlined the different steps that we have to take to apply our model to new data and how we can evaluate the model in terms of looking at failure cases and confusion matrices, let's actually apply these concepts in a concrete coding example using our previous digit classifier that we trained in the previous videos.